Fine. So today we are going to start with our next lecture of object-oriented system design, in which we are going to learn about the control statements, right? Basically, the concept of control statements or conditional statements are same as we have done in any type of programming language, whether it is C, and basically you have already studied C. So the concept are same, right? The only difference between using the programming languages are we apply the same logic, but we use different syntax. We use different pattern and we use different technique in defining the classes, functions, and many other things, right? So here what we are going to do, we are going to understand the conditional statements in this particular lecture. So basically, when we say conditional statements, what are these conditional statements? These are the ones which are also called as selection statements, and these are based on certain given condition. Like, I'm not going to give you the theoretical concept of this. I'll just give you an example and then we will move to the demo program, right? So in this particular, what we have, we are saying that we are going to use a particular condition, and according to the condition, we are going to make a decision, right? So it's a simple example. If we take, then we can say that if it is raining outside, the child will not go out to play. So the condition is, if it is raining outside. So this if condition is coming up, according to which we are going to take the action. And what is the action? If the child is going to play outside or not, that depends on the condition, whether it's raining outside or not. So if the condition is true, if the evaluation of the condition is true, a particular set of statement is executed. Otherwise, another set of statement is executed. Next thing, whenever we evaluate these particular conditional statements, we get a Boolean value. Now, what does this mean, Boolean value? See, we have a condition in which we are getting true or false, but in machine language, true or false is nothing, but it is being understood in the concept of 0 and 1, right? So that will be evaluated on the basis of 0 and 1, that is the Boolean values, true or false. 1 for true and 0 for false, right? So we are going to take up the first condition, that is first conditional statement, that is called as if statement. Now in this particular if statement, we are just moving to the syntax, how we use this particular, because you all basically know the concept of this. What it is, we are going to use if with the condition, and then we are going to start up with the curly braces, and then we are going to give these statements, the statements we need to execute if the condition is true, and we are going to close it with the curly braces, right? So what does it say? Whatever condition we are giving, if that particular condition is true, if that particular condition is true, only then these statements will be executed. Otherwise, if it is false, it will come out of this particular loop, right? So how do we do it? Let's take an example of this. We have taken a demo program. We are going to write the include IOStream. If you remember, this was what? This was the header file we are going to use in input output stream. We already told you what is namespace std. In this, we are going to define the functions with different names. Then we use the int main. What is this int main? This was the main function, where this particular main is the name of the function, right? Now, moving further, we are going to start up with the curly braces. This is the basic syntax of a C++ program. Now, what we are going to do, first of all, we are defining, or first of all, we are initializing a variable which has a data type of integer, right? So A is a variable which has an integer data type, and we are assigning it a value that is called as equal to 20 here. Second, similarly, we have initialize and we have defined integer variable which is named as b, integer data type, and the value assigned to is 30, and then the semicolon. Now here we are applying the if condition. Here starts the if condition. What does this if condition says? It says that if b is greater than a, this is the condition we are going to check, right? We have the values of b and a. So what we are going to do, if this condition is true, this particular statement will be executed, which is in the curly braces, right? So let's check it. B is greater than A. बी इज 30, ऑफकोर्स बी इज 30 एंड 20 इज ए, सो 30 इज ग्रेटर देन 20, सो दिस इज ट्रू, द कंडीशन इवेलुएटेड इज ट्रू, सो हेंस वी आर गोइंग टू एग्जीक्यूट दिस. सो द आउटपुट कंसोल विल हैव वॉट, इट विल प्रिंट b is greater than a. How it is going to print? Because we have given this particular c out. C out is used for printing the statement whatever we are giving in the quotes, and this particular sign is taken up, right? We are going to close the curly braces and return zero. So this is the point where we are using the if statement. Now another condition you can see here, what if it is a is greater than b. What if we change the condition as A is greater than B? Now in that condition, the value will be false. The Boolean value will be false because 20 is not greater than 30. So it will be false. Now what will happen? Another condition arises. In this particular, this will not be printed. Why? Because the condition is false. So it will come out of the loop. It will come out here, return zero, and will give finish the program. So in that particular condition, what we use the if else statement. When if condition is false, what will happen? So that is if else condition. Though how do we define it? What is the syntax of this? Same way, we are giving if the condition, the curly braces, the statements to be executed, else. Now if the condition is true, these particular statements will be executed, and if it is false, it will ignore this particular part and it will jump from here to statement 3, and this statement will be executed. So same condition, same way we take a demo program. Here we are taking the same concept, that is up till here we have already done if A is greater than B. If this condition is true, what it is going to print? It is going to print A is greater than B. And if it is false, what will happen? It will give A is smaller than B. So here A is 20 and B is 30. So A is not greater than B. So this particular condition is what? This particular condition is being false. So here when it is false, it will jump to this particular statement, and this particular statement will be ignored, and straight away the console will print what? A is smaller than B. Right? And lastly, it will close it, return zero, and close the braces. So this is how we are going to write the if else statement program. Now, moving further, we have the next type of conditional statement in which we have the nested if else. Now, what is nested if else? It is the same thing that we are using the concept of if else. The only thing is, if within a if condition, we are again deciding or taking up the decision of again the if condition. That means we are checking out if it is, let's take a condition. If the student is having attendance greater than 75, right? So this is first if condition. And if this is true, again, we are checking out one more condition, if condition. If the student is having the total percentage throughout 70%, then he is eligible for the placement drive. So what is this? This is if, and inside if we have one more condition. So we have to check, we have nested if. So this is like, if the attendance of a student is 75%, again we have to check one more condition. Let's say if the student is having total percentage 70% throughout marks, then he is eligible in the placement drive, else he is not. So this is what, within if there is one more if condition, if else condition, which is defined, and then we have the outer loop of if else, right? So let's take an example of this straight away. So this is a very basic example I have taken. Out of three numbers, you have to find out the largest number. So what we are doing, we are just, taking up the less number of code lines, code lines, with the help of which we can define the program. Now in this we are checking if A is greater than B. If this is true, right, then we are moving to this particular part. If this condition is true, then we are moving to this condition, and I am going to check, this is defined that A is greater than B, so A is greater than B, obviously A is greater. Now I have to check with C only. So if A is greater than C, if this is again yes, so which one is largest? A is greater than B and C, so A is the largest, right? Else I'm going to check what? If B is greater than C. So if B is greater than C, then B is the largest, else C is the largest. So this is the basic structure of nested if we are using, right? And this is a very important we have to define when we have to define the less number of code lines. Now next comes the switch statement, right? What is the switch statement? Switch statement is in which we have multiple branches of statements. See, if we have multiple nested, if we have multiple if then statements, then it would be very difficult to define in the program in a way with the if then else statement logic. So what we are going to use, we are going to use another concept of conditional statement that is called as the switch statement. So what is this? This is a multi-way branch statement. It is just a modified form of if else statement. And how do we use this? We define the switch, the number of switch, and we at the end we give a last condition that is called as the default condition. Default condition is executed only when none of the conditions are met which are defined in the switch statements. So let's see out the syntax and let's see it with the help of a demo program. How do we define it? This is again IOStream, header file, namespace, main function, starting of program logic. Then this is again what? This is we are going to define, initialize the variable, right, which is of an integer data type. We are going to define here. From here, we start the switch statement, right? So this is the where we are going to start the switch statement. We are going to give switch and braces E. So this is what? This is we have defined two. There will be two switch cases, the number of conditions we are going to check, right? So it can be four, it can be five, any number. So let's see, first of all, switch E, we are going to start up with the curly braces. Case one, whatever the case one is, that will be executed. Break, obviously, every time, just remember, within the two cases, between the two cases, we are going to use a break statement, right? With semicolon. Next, case two, again, the statements break, and there will be a default condition. See, we have already initialized E is equal to 2. So we are giving two cases. And apart from two cases, we are going to give the default condition. Now, what is this default condition? Default condition will be executed only when if none of the switch cases are true and none of the switch cases are matched, right? If any of the switch cases are matched, that particular case will be executed. And if none of them is matched, then the default condition will be executed. And lastly, again, you have to provide a break and then the closing of switch statement. So curly braces again, right? So this is how we are going to use the switch case. So this is an easier way of using many or multiple branch conditions. In those particular conditions where there are multiple branches statements, we use it. So let's see how we are going to define this. This is, again, we have initialized A is equal to 3. So here what it is, we have, this means what? Switch A. This means we are going to have three cases. And apart from three cases, one default case will also be there. So first of all, case one. Case one is C out, less than sign. One is stored in A. So this will be printed, right? Case two, this break. Case three, again, C out, break, and default, none of the values is matched and break. And lastly, the curly braces. So this will be the concept of switch case, right? You must have used this particular switch case in, defining the C program where you are using the, where you are developing a calculator can be defined as. So it's like addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. So all these cases are defined in this particular program, right? So now, next one is we have loops, which is very important, and the same concept which you have already studied about loops. There are basically, whenever we are re-executing a part of code number of times, a given number of times, that particular is called as a loop. So up till when a condition is met, we are going to re-execute a part of code with a given number of times that are defined as loops. Loops are of two types. One is entry controlled loop are called as, in which the condition is checked each time before entering the loop. If the condition is satisfied, then only the loop body gets executed. The loop body does not get executed if the condition is false in the first iteration. So what we are going to do, we are going to execute again and again the same part of the body till the condition is true. And once it is false, we are going to move out of that particular loop. So it can be defined with the help of two types of loops. One is for loop and the other one is called as the while loop. So I've given the syntax how we are going to use the for loop and the while loop. This is the for loop. Basic syntax. Aap sabko dekhkar yaad aa gaya hoga. This is what? See, in this for loop, what we are going to use, we are going to initialize, check the condition and increment it in single statement, right? You can see this particular for loop. This is what I is equal to zero. So this is what, this is the initialization, right? This is the initialization. I'm initializing I is equal to zero. Then I'm checking the condition. This is the condition check. I is less than N, right? Then again, we have semicolon, that is I plus plus. What is this doing? This is incrementing. This is incrementing the value. This is incrementing the value. This is the condition checking and this is the initialization, right? So in single statement, we are working on with the three concepts, right? So this is the for loop. We are going to start up with this. Certain actions are to be taken. That will be, or certain statements will be executed till this condition is true. Once this condition is false, the loop will move out of this loop. And up till the condition is true, this statement will be re-executed up till that time, right? Now, what is while statement says? While says that the syntax of a while loop, how do we define? We define while condition is being checked out here, and then the statements are to be executed. We'll see it in the, with the help of the demo program that will make us very clear about that. So first of all, let's see about the for loop. We have taken, let's say, for integer, this particular part is the same, which we are using again and again. For integer I is equal to zero, semicolon, I is less than 5, semicolon, I plus plus, right? And then within the curly braces, what we have C out I. Okay, so what we are doing here is we are going, initial value of I is zero. It is being checked with the condition if I is less than 5 or not. Then we are incrementing it and we are checking, we are executing this statement. So this statement will be executed how many times? 4 times. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 times, 5 times it will be executed and it is I less than 5. So once I is equal to 5, it will come out of the loop, right? So how many times it will be 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 will be returned in this particular program. Once the value of I is equal to 5, this condition becomes false. Once the I value of I is 5, this condition becomes false. And as soon as this condition is false, this will come out of the loop. Okay, and it will end the program. Now next thing, we have while loop. Now see, in this while loop, we have how we are going to give. In the for loop, we have already initialized it. Condition checking is done and incrementing is done in one statement only, that is for. But here we are doing it in different way. That is, we are initializing integer I is equal to 10 before starting up with the while loop. then we are giving up the while loop with the condition. The condition is stated with the while loop. This is how the syntax is defined for the while loop. And then we have curly braces, the statement that is to be executed till the condition I is less than 25 is true. Till then, this C out will be printing this I value, and then it will be incremented, and again this will loop will follow up, right? And it will follow up till the value is 25, because 25, when the I value is 25, it is, the condition is false, it is going to be defined. So what value it will be defined, the program will return what the values will be, the output will be I is equal to 10, it will start, right? The execution will take place because I is less than 25. C out will give I, so I 10. Increment will be done, it will be 11. So now I is equal to 11. Again, the condition will be checked whether 11 is less than 25. So yes, it is less than. Again, I will be printed, so it will be I, again 11. Again, increment will be done, plus 1, so 12. It will be 12. So this will be done again and again. So it will be printing 13, 14. Till which value? Till 24. Now see, as soon as we define the 24, the value will be incremented, right? It will become 25, and again it will check whether 25 is less than 25. So no, this is equal. So this is false, and it will come out of the loop with the value 25. So the print will be, the output will be 10 to 24, right? So this is how the while loop is going to be defined and run. Now next thing is, we have the header files. What are header files? We have already seen. I'm just going to tell you two header files which are very important. First is strings. Now what are strings? We already know that is, in characters we store the character, but when we have a sequence of characters to be stored, where do we store? We store it in strings, right? Whenever we are going to store a sequence of characters, that has to be stored in strings. Okay. Now strings, how these particular strings can be used? It can be imported with the help of C string library. This is a string function which are available in C++. Okay. So with the help of this C string, whenever we are going to use string functions, we need to import the library of C string in the program. We'll see it, how we are going to do is. One more thing, we have string functions. We have three string functions. One is string copy, strcpy. What does this mean? C1, comma C2. That means string C1 and C2. One string will be copied to the another. Okay. So it will be C2 will be copied in C1 also. The value or whatever is stored, which string is stored in C2, that will be copied to C1. Okay. Next is strcat. What is this? This is called for the concatenation. Concatenation means we are joining two strings. If we have like Anil in C1 and Sharma in C2. So when we concatenate, when we use this particular function, it will give you Anil Sharma. So it will join these particular two strings. Okay. Next is string length, strlen, and we define the s, that is the string. So it is going to return you the size or the length of the string s that is being defined. So let's see how it is being done with the help of a demo program. See, we have the string functions. First of all, what we need to do is, this is the header file which are used for IOStream. Next, we are going to import the C string library also. So this is again a header file which is to be included and to be imported in the program. So hash include C string. Okay. So this is how, if we are not using this particular include C string and we are using these particular string functions, it will give you error. Okay. Because these particular functions are defined in the predefined in the library C string. Okay. So now we have again using namespace int main, here starts. We have, let's say we have given character, we have taken a character array. Okay, so C1 character array, that is grade. Character array C2 as learning. What we have, we are going to print C out concatenation. We are going to use this function, that is strcat C1 comma C2. All right. Then we have C out for copy. We are going to use the string function strcpy C1 C2. This slash n is used for moving to the next line, as in C only. C out length, we are going to check the length of this string, strlen abc. This is the string we have given, and this slash n, and then return 0. Now in this, what will be the output of this? So output of first will be concatenation is equal to great learning. Great and then learning. This complete will be there. Okay. Next, for this particular, the output will be, it will be printed str c1 c2, that is learning, and again learning will be there. Why so? Because in c2 we have learning, and that will be copied in c1 also. So that is learning will be defined out in this. So if I print c1, then it will not give me great, it will give me learning. Okay, then c out length, I'm going to check the length of this particular string ABC, so I can see 1, 2, 3. So it will give the output as 3, because it will return me the value of the string length or the size of the string. So this is how the string functions are used with the help of the string, C string library function or the header file. Now next, the another type we use is math library. Now this particular library is used for mathematical functions. It is used or it is supported by this particular library. Whatever the mathematical calculations we are doing, we are going to define in this. And these are used, again, it can be imported directly with the help of math.h. This is the header file we have named it, right? So in this, we have number of functions such as sine, cos, double sine, double cos, tan, square root, then abs, power, floor, and whatever, right? So this is for sine value, returning the sine value, cos for returning cos value, tan returning the tangent value, square root giving the square root, abs, this is returning the absolute value, power double double, that is giving to define you return power, and then floor double, that is going to define you the lesser value of the integer and argument passed. So this is how